Welcome to worship on this sixth Sunday of Easter. And also to all you mothers out there, happy Mother's Day. In celebration of this special day and in loving thanks and appreciation to you, we have a carnation flower to give all mothers on your way out from worship today. We also invite everyone to tune in to the video recitation by Pastor Hinke of his Mother's Day poem, A Mother's Tears, which can be found on our website, our Facebook page, and our YouTube channel. As for announcements, I just want to remind you that we have our May Voters Assembly meeting taking place next Sunday, May 16th at 2:00 in the afternoon in the traditional sanctuary. We will be discussing our budget for the next fiscal year, which begins July 1st. We'll also provide updates for our plans in our COVID response policies and procedures, as well as a few other exciting ministerial actions taking place soon. Following the Voters Assembly, we will finally have our blessing and dedication of the Mission House. So I hope to see you there at the Voters Assembly and Mission House dedication, all starting at 2:00 in the afternoon on Sunday, May 16th. We have a blood drive coming this Wednesday, May 12th. The Oklahoma Blood Institute has a great need for blood donors at this time, so please sign up and help save a life this Wednesday. Finally, after serving for 8 years here at Holy Trinity, Lisa Kelly, our beloved church secretary, will be retiring on June 30th. We are grateful for Lisa's dedication over these past 8 years, for keeping our staff on track and being such a positive presence in the office. We look forward to see what God has in store for her and for Jeff in the next chapter of life. So when you see her, tell Lisa thanks and show her your appreciation for all that she has done. All other announcements can be found in the wrap or on our website. These have been your announcements in 2 minutes or less. Again, happy Mother's Day. Thank you, Lisa Kelly, and God's blessings on your worship.
I get the great pleasure of echoing all of those things. Happy Mother's Day. And thank you, Lisa Kelly, and welcome to worship this morning. Just a couple more things to tack onto your calendars this week. We're looking towards next Sunday afternoon as our twice a year voters meeting. If you want to see a copy of the church's budget before that meeting, there are extra copies in the church office. Just walk by and pick up one on your way out if you want to study up before next Sunday afternoon at 2:00. Also, this Wednesday at 7:15, this is for Confirmation Age students, there's not in-person confirmation class this Wednesday at 6:00, but at 7:15 is our Ascension Eve worship service. So a big celebration of the church, 40 days after Jesus rises from the dead, he ascends to his Father in heaven, and we celebrate the Ascension. So you're invited to be part of our Ascension Eve worship this Wednesday at 7:15. We look forward to seeing you there. We continue this morning our series of God in the Third Person, looking at the Holy Spirit, sometimes neglected, underestimated, or forgotten person of God, and all he's up to today in our midst, today in our hearts, today in our world. Looking at momentum in discipleship and how the Holy Spirit sort of pushes us forward in Jesus. So as we get ready this morning, I invite you to join me in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Pray with me if you would. Holy Spirit of God, you welcome us here this morning. You open doors, you open the word, you open your sacramental gifts to bring us into vibrant lives of purpose. Holy Spirit of God, you call us into the mysteries of faith, to believe what our eyes cannot see, to trust your guidance and direction, to go with confidence that wherever you lead is for our good and for your glory. Holy Spirit of God, we cannot praise you enough for how you come, for how you move, for who you are as our Lord and giver of life. We pray for a rich and powerful experience with your presence today, that we might be those building momentum in our discipleship following our Savior Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit, we pray, and fill the hearts of the faithful and kindle in us the fire of your love. Amen. Please stand for a call to worship this morning. With hearts of faith alive in the Holy Spirit, alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia, come Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of the faithful and kindle in them the fire of your love. Alleluia. Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Oh, come, let us worship him. Alleluia. The Lord bless your worship this morning.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. What our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come. Your glory.
invite you to be seated. You know, there are things that you become more aware of as you get older, too. One of them is how imperfect my vision is, and it gets more imperfect every day. And that applies to our life of faith as well, because the Holy Spirit is here. Holy Spirit is doing his job the whole time, and sometimes I just can't see it. Sometimes I'm not aware of it. In my imperfect vision, I can't see all the Spirit is accomplishing among us and in us and through us all the time. The Word of God talks about it this way, that the Spirit of God is unseen except when he moves. When he moves something, when he moves someone, when he moves us. That's his job. We can see the Spirit then as he is moving, propelling this world closer and closer to God's goodness. That's when we see him. We get to see the goodness of God moving in this world. You're seeing the Holy Spirit. When you see the goodness of God moving in you, that's the Holy Spirit. My imperfect vision also is clear enough to see that sometimes I get off course. As the Holy Spirit of God is moving me through this world, sometimes I reject it, go my own way. We veer off and we end up somewhere far from where the Holy Spirit would ask us to be. And so we have this moment, this course correction moment, as we return to the Holy Spirit with hearts broken by our mistakes, broken by our decisions, broken by the strangeness, the unknown of the road ahead of us, and we ask, Holy Spirit of God, put me back on the path that you've called me to. We confess together. Spirit of God, we give you thanks for calling us by the gospel of Christ, creating faith in our hearts to build faith stronger. You've instructed us not to neglect your word, not to neglect gathering in worship with fellow believers. For the times we neglect your word or we feel no desire to worship you, we pray, forgive me, O Holy Spirit. Spirit of God, you desire to fill us with grace upon grace so that we might live fully the spiritual gifts you provide to us, that we might bear your fruit in our lives. For the times when we've chosen not to grow into a Christ-like example or bear your fruit in our daily living, we pray, forgive me, O Holy Spirit. Spirit of God, change our hearts with your grace. Draw us closer to Jesus that our lives might live in and live out the joy of your salvation. For the sinfulness we've inherited and for the sins we choose, we pray, forgive me, O Holy Spirit. Have mercy on me, on us, O Lord, for the sake of Jesus, and forgive all our sins. Amen. Jesus promised the Holy Spirit. In his word, he said, the Holy Spirit will come and he will convict the world of sin. And he does that in your heart and mine. And then he sets the course right. He steers us back to where we should be pointed to Jesus, God's own Son, who in mercy died for you on the cross. And through him wins forgiveness for all your sins, past, present, and future. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, in the joy of the Holy Spirit, I proclaim to you this morning, your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so now, as the forgiven people of God, we join in a feast. We celebrate all that God has done and seeks to do in your life and mine through the power of his Holy Spirit by celebrating this supper. When we come to this holy meal, we do with a few things in mind. We recognize that we're sinful and need a Savior. We just confess that. We recognize that all who come for communion at this church believe that this is Christ's true body, his true blood, not a symbol, his real presence. And through this eating and drinking, it's the Holy Spirit who is working to bring forgiveness, life, and salvation into your heart and mine. And then we go away from this meal confident in the grace that we've received and intentional about trying to flee from sin and flee from temptation by the Spirit's guidance. So if that's your confession, I invite you to stand with me. And receive this blessing. The Lord be with you. Would you pray? Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of all creation, because you've had mercy on sinners like us and have given your only Son, Jesus Christ, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have eternal life with you. We give you thanks for this holy supper, the one you've prepared for us. If you've spoken your word of forgiveness to us in Christ, we pray that we would truly taste that grace and mercy now, the one that comes to us in the sacred meal set before us. Help us to faithfully eat Christ's body and drink his blood as he's called us to do in his own covenant, so that we might one day behold your glory face to face. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Just like our Lord and Savior entrusts us with that prayer, he entrusts us now with this gift, this Holy Supper shared with his disciples and commanded to be observed over and over as often as possible, as the people of God come together in the Spirit to proclaim the death and resurrection of Christ our Savior, the Savior who comes with forgiveness of sins for us and for the world. Because on the night when he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The gifts of God for the people of God. We'll dismiss from the front. I'll invite my friend Avery and my friend Mark. We'll get Josh on the other side in just a minute. Commune this side first, and as we commune, I invite you to sing.
The atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. The atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. With your love. atmosphere is changing now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here.
May this eating and drinking of your Savior's true body and blood strengthen you in faith today and into life everlasting. Go in peace and joy. Amen. We sing a new song this morning. Rest on us.
Spirit, come move over us.
You may be seated. So we welcome forward Miss Peggy Gruno, sharing how the Holy Spirit is moving in mission through the LWML.
Good morning. On Mother's Day, we thank God for Christian mothers who nourish children physically and spiritually. LCMS deaconesses are spiritual mothers, nurturing others to grow a healthy faith. They continue the momentum of discipleship through many various ministries. Today, we focus on an LWML grant that will enable women from our international partner churches to pursue their calling to become deaconesses.
The Lutheran Church Missouri Synod's deaconesses are women who are full-time professional church workers trained to share the gospel of Jesus Christ through a ministry of works of mercy, spiritual care, and teaching the Christian faith. Educational and financial support is needed for our partner churches who have introduced deaconess training programs within their church body. Due to educational needs and financial struggles, the programs in partner countries cannot afford to have undergraduate studies. Funding would help promoting theological education to the underprivileged women who have a passion to take confessional theological studies to serve the church. Funding would also provide educational and financial support to our Lutheran seminaries and institutions to support our own daughters of the church.
Please pray responsively with me. Blessed Jesus, you set an example of caring and serving for your followers. You chose each of us to bear fruit that will last. Thank you for the women who are training to become deaconesses in the Philippines, Latvia, Liberia, Indonesia, Malaysia, and India. Send your spirit to empower these women as they study. Give them wisdom to understand how to apply what they learn so they can bless others physically and spiritually. Use our mites today to provide the educational support these women need. Equip and encourage your people everywhere to boldly follow you for your honor, Jesus. Amen.
Thanks, Peggy, for sharing that. Following the service, you can place your mites in the mite box that's just to the left as you exit service, or there's a way to do it electronically too. You can follow the text to give instructions that are either on the screen or printed in your bulletin. Well, Peggy's already effectively gathered us for prayer, and so we continue. We continue lifting the prayers of these people, the prayers that are on our hearts, the prayers that the Spirit would speak through us. And so there'll be a moment in this service where you're the prayer leaders too. I'll get us started, but then turn things over where you're the prayer leader. I invite you to lead us in prayer, and then to end with the words, Lord, in your mercy, so that we can make your prayer our own too with the words, hear our prayer. We pray. For all the baptized people of God in Christ and for all others around the world according to their needs, we pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed Lord God, you invite us to freely come and hear your word, and you invite us to pray at all times and in all circumstances. You say you don't reject our prayers or ever remove your steadfast love from us. So hear us now. Answer us in love for your whole church and for all people. According to their needs, bless and increase our faith, that we might rightly fear you and learn what you've done for our souls. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of all, you make known the good news of peace through our Savior Jesus. So we pray that you would bless and direct the work of our missionaries, that in every nation there would be people led by the Holy Spirit, people who fear God, who do what is right, who believe in Jesus and receive the forgiveness of sins through his name. Continue to bless the work of the Lutheran Women's Missionary League and the work of all auxiliary ministries of the LCMS, that your salvation might be proclaimed in the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord of life, we pray for members celebrating birthdays this week, including Anderson Barenberg, Thomas Kors, Linda Hansen, Troy Hitzman, Barbara Shell Ryle, Audrey Cluck, Pam Gray, Don Schert, Al Nance, Patricia Slope, Lily Johnson, Deborah Steiner, Abby Collison, Patrick MD, Linda Johnson, Jeff Mieser, Elijah Elderton, David Krottinger, Emily McCracken, Hazel Stockstill, Holly Winterson, Stephanie Gerling, and Katie Payne. In baptism, you claim them, O Father. You poured out your mercy and grace, so let your children continue to experience those baptismal blessings, and might they be a blessing through every aspect of their earthly life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of love, we pray for those celebrating marriage blessings this week as they mark their anniversaries, including Guy and Tammy Jackson, Brian and Melinda Gerlach, Carl and Jennifer DeMint, Scott and Sarah Paul, Ben and Jordan Post, Bill and Patty Frenier, and Steve and Marilyn Miller, who are marking 25 years together on Tuesday. Let the love of each of these couples grow stronger through every joy and sorrow they experience together, until that day when one shall lay the other into your arms for eternity. O Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the hour of trial and in the moment of trouble, you're there. You're there, Father. So hear us as we cry to you for mercy on behalf of the sick, the troubled in mind, those who are wounded in heart, those to whom death draws near, as well as those who feel the sting of death as they grieve the loss of a loved one. We continue to mourn for Rick and Jody Lube as they mourn the death of Jody's mother, Jean Bauer. But we also seek your tender care and healing upon Bill Barnett, Dylan Crawford, Lincoln Crawford, Carol Garner, Sarah Paul, Gloria Schwizo, Ray and Rosalie Seebeck, and all others on our prayer list and in our hearts. Because you know their needs. They're your children. So deliver them from affliction, we pray. Deliver them from heartache and from distress according to your will. Sustain them in the abiding hope of the resurrection in Christ, our living Savior. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear the prayers and petitions of your gathered people at this time. Hear our prayer. Hear our prayer. Hear our prayer. Be merciful to us, Heavenly Father, and hear our prayers. Grant to us the grace of your Holy Spirit that we might be led into all truth and be steadfast in the confession of Christ. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And on this day, there are people in our midst, people who are close to our hearts, people, even if they're far away, are always present in how they've shaped and grown us through our lives. We celebrate mothers, and we pray for them together as a community of faith. O Lord Almighty, on this day, set aside to honor and remember mothers, we give you thanks for the mothers in our lives, in our midst. We're grateful that you chose to give us life through them, and that they receive the gift of life from your hands as well. We thank you for the women who raised us, who are mothers in childhood, whether birth mom or adopted mom, an older sister, aunt, grandmother, stepmother, or someone else who stepped into the role of motherhood. We thank you for those women who held us and fed us, who cared for us and kissed away our pain, who sacrificed so much for us. As they've shown us your great love, we pray that our own lives would reflect that same love, that our mothers would be pleased to call us their children. Hear us, O Lord, as we pray together. For older moms whose children are grown, grant them joy and satisfaction for a job well done. We pray for new moms experiencing the changes they couldn't predict. Grant them the rest and peace as they trust you for the future. We pray for pregnant women whose motherhood has begun and who either joyfully anticipate or hesitantly fear the day when they'll hold their newborn child. Grant them patience and health, peace and good counsel in the coming. We pray for moms who face the demands and challenges of single parenthood. Grant them strength and wisdom. Make us ready to give them support. We pray for moms who enjoy financial abundance.
Give them time to share with their families and to instill within their children a generous heart toward them. We pray for moms who are raising their children in financial difficulty, even poverty. Grant them relief and justice. Direct us toward assisting without hesitation and without judgment. We pray for stepmoms who strive toward healthy relationships. Grant them patience, understanding, and love. We pray for moms who are separated from their children. Grant them faith, hope, and perseverance, and use us as your ambassadors of reconciliation. We pray for moms in marriages that are in crisis. Grant them support and insight, keeping Christ at the center of their marriage. We pray for moms who have lost children.
Grant them comfort and resurrection in Jesus Christ.
We pray for the mothers who aborted their children. Grant them healing and peace. Make us ready to receive them, to extend a message of forgiveness. We pray for moms who gave up their children for adoption. Grant them peace and confidence as they trust in your providence. We pray for foster moms and adoptive mothers. Grant them joy and gratitude for the gift you provided and wisdom in difficult circumstances for those in their care. We pray for the girls and women who think about one day being moms. Grant them wisdom and discernment, patience and hope. We pray for women who desperately want or wanted to be moms. Grant them grace to accept. We pray for all the women who have assumed the mother's role in a child's life. Grant them joy in the appreciation of others and make us ready to likewise care for the needs of all children. We pray for those children who are grieving the loss of their mother, especially in the past year. Grant them comfort and hope in Christ's resurrection. Lord, we thank you for the gift of motherhood. We thank you for the many examples of faithful mothers in Scripture like Sarah, Hannah, Elizabeth, and Lois. Hear now the first names of other women who've inspired us by their motherly examples. Carla Jo. Gail. Gloria. We're mindful this day of all these women, especially Mary, the mother of our Lord Jesus Christ, who had the courage and faith to say yes to your calling into this special role. May all mothers gathered here today, and those for whom we've named graciously, would they be examples of faith, hope, love, and courage by your Spirit, modeling for us all what it means to be a follower of Christ. Bless them on this special day and always through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now gather for our message. As we've been looking at the Holy Spirit and what he's all about, we'll look at the chronicle of the Holy Spirit, the book of Acts, which could easily be called Acts of the Holy Spirit. And we get to chapter 9. Last week we were in chapter 8 as the deacon Philip goes out and baptizes the treasurer of the kingdom of Ethiopia, this high-powered cabinet minister, picks up a roadside hitchhiker, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, they're joined together in faith and brotherhood through the waters of baptism. And now this morning, the story continues. So Acts chapter 9, starting at verse 1. Now Saul was still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. He went to the high priest and requested letters from him to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any men or women who belonged to the way, he might bring them as prisoners to Jerusalem. And as he traveled and was nearing Damascus, a light from heaven suddenly flashed around him. Falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul said. "I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting," he replied. "But get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men who were traveling with Saul stood speechless, hearing the sound, but seeing no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he couldn't see anything. So they took him by the hand and led him into Damascus. He was unable to see for 3 days, and he did not eat or drink. There was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias, and the Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias, here I am, Lord," Ananias replied. "Get up and go to the street called Straight," the Lord told him, "to the house of Judas, and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, since he's praying there. In a vision, he's seen a man named Ananias coming in and placing his hands on him so that he might regain his sight. Lord, Ananias answered, I've heard from many people about this man, how much harm he's done to your saints in Jerusalem, and he has the authority here from the chief priests to arrest all who call on your name. But the Lord said to Ananias, go, for this man is my chosen instrument to take my name to Gentiles, kings, and Israelites. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Ananias went and entered the house. He placed his hands on him and said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road you were traveling, has sent me so that you might regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And at once something like scales fell from his eyes, and he regained his sight. Then he got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. Saul was with the disciples in Damascus for some time, and immediately he began proclaiming Jesus in the synagogues. He is the Son of God, and all who heard him were astounded and said, isn't this the man in Jerusalem who was causing havoc for those who called on this name and came here for the purpose of taking them as prisoners to the chief priests? But Saul grew stronger and kept confounding the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Messiah. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. As those who have been called by the name of Jesus into this shared faith, I invite you to share that faith now. Stand if you're able, so we make confession of our faith in our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
You may be seated, and I invite, actually, Pastor Brackish, can you stand here for a minute? If you're a child, I've got a special treat here for you. And here, let me see one. It's a pinwheel. And I want you to pay attention to the sermon if you want. And every time you hear the Holy Spirit, or you hear the word Spirit, I want you to and just watch your pinwheel, okay? All right, so if you want a pinwheel, come on up, kids. Hopefully I've got enough. I think we do. All right. We got enough, because we're going to be talking about the Holy Spirit here. Last week, Pastor Brackage talked about the Holy Spirit as a light, or working this light of flame, this flame of faith in us. We're going to look at it from a different angle now. Oh, one more here. Just enough. Perfect. Oh. All right. Thank you, Pastor Brackage. Well, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The goal was ambitious. Experts were eager to contribute and to explore in this new frontier. The public was highly interested in the story in the paper all the time, and money was thrown at the project, all of it on this quest to harness the wind in a revolutionary technology that would change the world. At the turn of the 20th century, Samuel Pierpont Langley set out to become the first man to pilot an airplane, and he had every ingredient for success. There was no reason why it wouldn't be him. Langley was a senior officer at the Smithsonian Institution. He had gained notoriety while working at the Harvard Observatory College and was now a mathematics professor at the U.S. Naval Academy. He had powerful and influential friends in business and in government, the likes of Andrew Carnegie and Alexander Graham Bell. The War Department had awarded him a $50,000 grant in his quest to harness the wind in flight. And
amount that would equivalent to $1.5 million today. He had a dream team of the brightest and best minds and talent of the day working beside him. They had access to the best materials to conduct tests and to construct the finest airplane the world has ever seen. And to top it all off, he had the press following his every move. The country was riveted by Samuel Pierpont Langley and his quest to harness the wind. If anyone was going to succeed, it would be him and no other. Except for the fact that a few hundred miles away in Dayton, Ohio, there were two brothers who were busy working on their own flying contraption. Their mother, Susan, was among the few women of the era who had received a college education with an inclination towards science and mathematics. It was Susan's influence and inspiration that set her sons on their own amateur quest to harness the wind in flight. They had no government funding, but had to pay for their project out of the proceeds of their humble bicycle shop. Not a single person working on their team had a college education. Some didn't even have a high school diploma. Unlike Langley, these brothers lacked the funding, the resources, the education, and the notoriety. They certainly didn't have the press following them around everywhere. They had failed time after time in this project. And although no press were present in Kitty Hawk, North Carolina on December 17, 1903, the world still today remembers the names of Orville and Wilbur Wright for successfully harnessing the wind in the first airplane piloted by men. The Wright brothers were driven by the desire to change the world for the better. Meanwhile, Samuel Pierpont Langley was driven only by the desire to make a name for himself. And so when he was beaten to the punch by a bunch of amateurs, rather than join their efforts to change the world, rather than build upon their success and make a good thing better, he was so angry that he quit entirely. And he's thus been forgotten to history. I bring up this story first to point to the influence one mother had on the history of the world. Had it not been for the curiosity of Susan Wright instilling within her sons the love of science and mathematics, the world would likely not know the names of the Wright brothers. The role of a mother is huge, so happy Mother's Day, and thank you to all you world-changing mothers out there. But more importantly, I tell you about Langley and the Wright brothers, their study of aerodynamics and the quest to harness the wind, all to help us continue our conversation about the Holy Spirit. Like I said, Pastor Brackage started us on this discussion of our God in the third person, the Holy Spirit. There we go, there were a few of them. As he talks about how the Spirit ignites the fire of faith in our hearts, casting the light of Christ into the darkness of sin. So we have this image in mind of the Spirit who ignites the flame of faith. Today I want us to consider the concept of the Spirit blowing like the wind, propelling faith's flight forward like a piloted plane. But whereas Langley and the Wright brothers sought to harness the wind, when it comes to our momentum in discipleship, we find that it's actually the Spirit who harnesses us. It's interesting, in Hebrew, the language of the Old Testament, the word for Spirit is ruach. You really have to put the ch in there at the end to make it work. So the ruach can also mean wind or breath. So it was the ruach of God that hovered over the waters of the deep at creation. It was the ruach of God that was breathed into Adam's freshly made lungs. It was the ruach of God which sent the waters fleeting from the earth after the flood. It was the ruach of God that created a highway in the Red Sea of dry ground for the Israelites to cross in their exodus. It was the ruach of God that provided quail for Israel in the wilderness for 40 years. The ruach of God which sometimes brought the Lord's judgment, and the ruach of God which breathed into new life in those dry bones for Ezekiel. This ruach, this wind, this breath, this Spirit of God was active all throughout the Old Testament, propelling the mission of God forward in and through and for his people. And this wind keeps on blowing. It keeps on blowing in the New Testament. The momentum continues to build. The New Testament was written in Greek, and in Greek, the word for Spirit is pneuma with a P. It's from this word pneuma that we get words like pneumonia, which is a condition of the lungs, which affects your breathing, right? We also get the word pneumatic, describing devices operated by moving air through them, sort of like generic wind. Because it turns out, wouldn't you know, just like in Hebrew, the Greek word for spirit, pneuma, can also mean wind or breath. So in the New Testament, when we see, I've mentioned to this group before, when Jesus rises from the dead, he appears to his disciples and he breathes pneuma upon his disciples. And he says, receive the Holy Spirit. And then he sends them out on a mission to forgive the sins of the world. In 2 weeks, we'll read about the account of Pentecost when in the upper room, it was in Jerusalem, it was filled with a mighty rushing pneuma as the Holy Spirit came with a wind and empowered the apostles to proclaim the name of Jesus. In a letter to Timothy, we read about how all scripture is breathed out, pneuma, by God. And we call it the inspiration of scripture. The word spirit is there in inspiration. But before all that, in John chapter 3, Jesus compares the Holy Spirit to the wind. He says to Nicodemus, the Pharisee in the dark, whose flame of faith had yet been ignited, he says to him, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, Jesus says, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with the one who is born of the Spirit. So early on in his ministry, Jesus is describing the Holy Spirit like the wind blowing. You know, if you put your hand out there trying to catch the wind, you know what you got? Nothing. Because you can't catch the wind. You can't grab onto it because it's always on the move. You can try to grasp it, but it always just has this way of slipping through your fingers every time. The wind is a powerful force, and it's only visible in how it puts things in motion, like flags waving in the air, or like leaves blowing along the ground, or like pinwheels spinning as you blow upon them. The same is true of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is always on the move. The Holy Spirit is a powerful force only visible in how he puts things in motion, how he puts people in motion and in mission. And if you are only born of the flesh, you will not grasp the Spirit, the pneuma, the ruach, because it turns out you can't harness the Spirit. No, the Spirit harnesses you, which brings us to our reading from Acts 9, where we see the Spirit on display, propelling God's people on an adventure in discipleship in faith's flight. It begins with a guy named Saul trying to harness the Spirit in a sense. Saul would describe himself as a Hebrew of Hebrews, a Pharisee, so zealous that if you looked at his life, he would appear blameless. He was a guy with a great education, surrounded by the brightest and best of scribes and rabbis that Jerusalem had to offer. He had the backing of the Jewish rulers. He had friends in high places sent with their funding and their authority to travel the 150 miles to Damascus, all in his quest to capture Christians. Here was a guy with great notoriety among the Jews. If anyone was going to harness the ruach, the pneuma, if anyone was going to harness the wind-like spirit of God, it would be him. It'd be Saul and no other. Certainly not these amateurs operating outside of their homes. So it makes sense that Acts 9:1 tells us that Saul was breathing pneuma, murderous threats against the Christians. He's trying to harness the wind, but the thing is that the Spirit doesn't breathe murderous threats, but love and compassion. What Saul soon realizes is you can't harness the Spirit. No, the Spirit harnesses you. In John chapter 15, Jesus tells his disciples, remember, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit. Jesus does the choosing of his followers, and then he sends the Spirit to grab hold of them, to ignite their faith and propel them forward in his power and mission. The Spirit breathes love and compassion. So it comes as no surprise when just outside of Damascus, Jesus confronts Saul and his entourage of temple guards. There's a bright flash of light around them. It's not just the sun shining a little extra special that day. No, it's a light from heaven itself breaking through the cosmos and pinpointed right there on Saul, like a magnifying glass to an ant unsuspecting below him. Saul is brought to his knees in an instant, like a plane whose takeoff is delayed due to an intense crosswind. Saul is grounded. His mission is at a halt. A booming voice calls to him, and he answers, "Who are you, Lord?" He knows the answer, but he's afraid of what that means. Then comes the reply, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." And Jesus sends him into Damascus to wait. Immediately, Saul is struck with blindness. Up to that point, Saul, like Nicodemus in John 3, was walking around in spiritual darkness. He was blind to the truth in Christ. But for the next 3 days, Saul would be sitting in a physical darkness, experiencing real blindness. And in this account, we see this great reversal that's taken place. Saul, who desired to dash Christians to the ground, now lies face down in the dirt. Saul, who wished to lead imprisoned believers from Damascus to Jerusalem, is now led, imprisoned by blindness, into Damascus. Saul, who acted with the authority of the high priest, now breaks ties with the Jerusalem hierarchy upon meeting Jesus, the great high priest. Saul, who came to triumph over the Christian faith, is now completely humiliated by the one he came to snuff out. Saul, who came to make a name for himself, is now going to have to suffer for the name of Jesus. Saul, who came to harness the Spirit, is now, after 3 days, about to be harnessed himself instead. For just as Saul received that command to go into Damascus, there was another Christian convert by the name of Ananias who had received the same command, "Go. Go, for this man is my chosen instrument," God says. "He's my chosen instrument to take my name to Gentiles, to kings, and to Israelites." Against Ananias' better judgment, against his questioning of God, Jesus is commanding him, "Go. Because remember, you didn't choose me. I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit in my name." So Ananias goes to bear fruit in Jesus' name. He goes because out of all the Christian converts in Damascus, Jesus appointed him, chose him for this task. Out of all the Christian converts in town, the Spirit harnessed him to do this task with Saul. Ananias goes not to hold a sinner accountable. No, the law had already done its work, and Saul was feeling the worst of it. Ananias goes to speak some of the most powerful, most beautiful words Saul had ever heard up to that point. I mean, just imagine it. Saul is sitting there in darkness. He's neither ate nor drank in the past 3 days. He's probably cried more tears and prayed more prayers than he ever has in his life. He's alone, trying to make sense of it all by himself. And then just as his trip to Damascus was interrupted by a booming voice, so now his prayers and his tears are interrupted with a new voice. "Brother Saul." Just days ago, Saul's trying to kill him, and Ananias calls him brother, calls his enemy brother. "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road you were traveling, the same Jesus who accused you of persecuting him, that Jesus has sent me not to accuse you of your sin, not to persecute you any further for failing God, not to tell you to do more good works. No, he has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." To Saul, these would have had to have been the most beautiful words he'd ever heard, because up to that point, Saul had only ever heard the law. Saul had only ever heard of his own need to do good works, to try to harness the Spirit for himself. He has only ever accused others of their sin and their failings. He has only ever heard Jesus confront him in his sin. But now Saul hears the words of the gospel, words of forgiveness and healing. And as soon as he regained his sight, Saul was baptized, because you see, it's really a resurrection story that's happening here in Acts 9. Saul emerged from those 3 days of darkness, breaking through the Spirit-filled baptismal waters as a new creation, ready to begin a new life in the light of Christ. And from there on, it says, Saul immediately went about proclaiming Jesus in the synagogues, saying, "He is the Son of God." Saul was filled with the Holy Spirit. And just as history has long forgotten the name of Samuel Pierpont Langley, so the world has all but forgotten the name Saul. We prefer instead to refer to him as his Roman name, Paul, Apostle of Christ. Unlike Langley, Paul didn't just quit when he was brought to his knees. No, he joined the mission to change the world. What else could he do? I mean, Paul was chosen by Jesus, filled with the Holy Spirit, and is propelled into the world, putting Christ's mission in motion on faith's flight. Like a child blowing dandelion seeds into the air, or like gusts of wind carrying pollen to new places, even causing your allergies to flare up, so the Spirit blew through Paul to bring the gospel seeds to fruition and to bear fruit in the name of Jesus. What else could he do? Because you can't grab hold of the wind, you can't grab hold of the Spirit, but when the Spirit grabs hold of you, he pulls you along for a wild ride sometimes in faith's flight. What else could you do when you are filled with the Holy Spirit? And that, my friends, is the point. The disciples were filled with the Spirit and immediately proclaimed the message of the risen Christ. What else could they do? They were filled with the Spirit, and the momentum of discipleship had begun. The first few thousand Christians were daily devoted to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and the prayers. But what else could they do? They were filled with the Holy Spirit. They were experiencing the momentum of discipleship. Stephen was just some guy, some deacon, who had the nerve to stand up to others in the name of Jesus, and he died for it. But what else was he going to do? He's filled with the Holy Spirit. Of course he's going to do that. He's experiencing the momentum of discipleship. Philip was not an apostle, not an evangelist, not a trained teacher. But when he saw the Ethiopian, he had to tell him about Jesus. What else was he going to do? He's filled with the Holy Spirit. He's in the momentum of discipleship. Ananias was afraid of Saul and what he would do. And yet he was bold enough to go to this house on Straight Street and meet his would-be assassin and proclaim the word of Christ to him. What else was he going to do? He was filled with the Holy Spirit, experiencing the momentum of discipleship. Paul had absolutely no business being an ambassador for Christ, but ended up becoming the most famous, most impactful evangelists and theologians whom God put forward in changing the world, because he was filled with the Holy Spirit. So what else was he going to do? That's the momentum of discipleship. That's the movement of the Holy Spirit in the world. So what about you? I started this sermon by telling you about the very first flight. Let me tell you about a very recent flight that happened. You may have heard about it or read about it on the news. Lavinia Moonga was the young lady's name. She was traveling for vacation from Salt Lake City, Utah to Hawaii. Little did she know when she boarded the flight that there was another passenger on board with her. That she was 29 weeks pregnant and by the end of the flight would give birth to this baby on an airplane over the Pacific Ocean. It just so happened, thanks be to God, that there was a doctor and three NICU nurses on board. What are the odds? They helped her deliver the child and they helped to care for Lavinia until landing. While her baby boy Raymond is still in the NICU today, Lavinia is experiencing a new life on this, her first Mother's Day. Now, I've never been pregnant before. But you hear these kinds of stories occasionally, right? Or the gal didn't know that she was pregnant. And I just have to wonder how a woman can go 29 weeks without realizing she's pregnant. Is that anyone here before I keep talking? Okay. How does one go about carrying this life within you without knowing it or showing it? How do you go on without living like there's this life in you, kicking you and prodding you and making you uncomfortable sometimes and causing lifestyle changes in the process? How does that happen? I question these things until I look at myself in the mirror and I look at the church today, and I wonder about these things until I look at Christians, myself included, and I see a people sometimes living like they're unaware they've been filled with the Holy Spirit and you've got this new life in you. You've got a new life in you on board faith's flight. Now, I'm not saying we all need to go out and do what Paul did and try to convince the Jews that Jesus was the Messiah, but that's a great task if you're up for it. I'm not telling you to go and do all the things that the apostles did, go heal a blind guy, though that's an amazing thing if you can do it. I simply want you to be aware that you have the Holy Spirit in you. You have a new life welling up inside of you. You are not only born of the flesh, you have been born of the Spirit and have a new life inside of you. To paraphrase Ananias' message, brothers and sisters in Christ, the Lord Jesus, who appears to you on your life's road, has sent me so that you may regain your sight again and again to remind you that you have been filled with the Holy Spirit. So what does that look like to be filled with the Holy Spirit? It looks like a mother teaching her children characteristics like leadership, like humble service and respect for others, like how to apologize and how to forgive and not hold a grudge. Being filled with the Holy Spirit looks like a father reading the Bible or the small catechism to his children, because confirmation should not be the first time nor the last time they hear about these things. Being filled with the Holy Spirit looks like parents showing their children the importance of their faith before all else through regular church attendance, even when it's inconvenient, even when you're on vacation, I would add. And then you talk about God's word in your home from Monday through Saturday. Being filled with the Holy Spirit looks like spouses making real sacrifices for their marriage, not giving up when things are difficult, but working through it together, even if it's a long, hard road. Being filled with the Holy Spirit looks like Christians joining in Bible study and devotions, strengthening your faith and your scriptural knowledge for yourself and for others around you so that you can be prepared to give an answer for the hope that you have in Christ. Being filled with the Holy Spirit looks like Christians using our language to build up others and to point them to Jesus, looking at our enemies as a brother or a sister, not tearing down those who disagree with you. Being filled with the Holy Spirit looks like recognizing that there is a new life inside of you, and that kicking, that prodding, that uncomfortable feeling you get in certain situations is there for a reason. It's the Holy Spirit telling you to get your act together and to change your lifestyle. Being filled with the Holy Spirit looks like joining a congregation, not out of convenience and not to make Grandma Schmidt happy, but for the sake of joining a community in life together. It looks like seeing a brother or a sister who's cried so many tears lately, he's prayed more prayers than ever before, and interrupting their tears and their prayers with a beautiful word of hope and forgiveness and healing. It's being there for others in the unexpected times, in the unexpected places, like a doctor and three NICU nurses on a flight, ready to help bring your new life to fruition, because you're not alone in faith's flight, no matter how you feel. Being filled with the Holy Spirit looks like all these things and so much more, and it is rarely easy to do it right all the time, but the momentum of discipleship has begun and it continues. There will be times when you feel like you're not equipped for the job, because you're a sinner. But so was Saul. So was Ananias. So am I. We are all sinners, born of the flesh, sinners from the moment of our conception in our mother's womb. But Christ died for your sins. Christ rose to give you a new life. And in baptism, you have been reborn, born of the Spirit with a new life in you. God in Christ has chosen you and appointed you to bear fruit right where you are in your life. You are filled with the Holy Spirit. So what else would you be doing? We confess in the small catechism that the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel. Yeah, I believe that. He has enlightened me with his gifts. Oh, I don't feel like I've got gifts, but I believe it. He has sanctified and kept me in the true faith. In other words, we don't harness the Spirit harnesses us, and he has given us all that we need to be disciples in motion on a mission, even when it's hard. Because the momentum of discipleship that began 2,000 years ago is as strong a force as ever. Like the wind visible in how it moves, so the Spirit becomes visible through the lives of the baptized, moving us, the redeemed people of God, to bear fruit of discipleship in our everyday lives in the name of Jesus. So get ready for takeoff. Come soon, Lord Jesus. Amen. I invite our band forward, and for the congregation to please stand for our sending and benediction. To God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory in his holy church forever and ever. Amen. Christ died. Christ is risen. Christ shall come again. Jesus said, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them to observe all I have commanded you. Love God, love one another, and love your neighbor. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. We sing our closing song.
As the road may seem, I'll follow where your spirit leads. Broken as my life may be, I will give you every piece. I hear you call. Nothing is a sacrifice. Oh, use me how you want to, God. Have your throne within my heart. I hear you call. I am available. I say, yes, Lord, I am available.
Go in God's peace. Happy Mother's Day. Moms, be sure to grab a flower on your way out.
And say,
oh.
Who am I that the highest king would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love.